I met Mother Teresa myself in Albania. I always remember what she said. My sisters are all over the world, and the only place we were put out of was Belfast, and we were put out by the church.
They packed up and went and left. And it was the saddest day in my life.
Why did they throw a saint out onto the street?
Armored cars and tanks and guns came to take away our sons. But every man will stand behind the man behind the wire.
Spring Hill was basically the front line. Day and daily, there was always operations carried out by the IRA. The British Army would come in and attack the community. It was a 24-hour battle.
In the 1970s in Ballymurphy, there was a lot of poverty, and that was true of different parts of Belfast, but particularly the West.
The level of unemployment was unbelievable. I mean, 50% of all adults were unemployed.
Our people were down on their knees looking for help.
It's very hard to crawl from the bottom, and the people in Ballymurphy are really on the bottom socially. And it's desperate hard to crawl, you know, try and drag yourself up. And we need help.
The 1970s witnessed some of the darkest days in Northern Ireland's history. Violence and social deprivation saw many areas marginalised. Ballymurphy, in the heart of West Belfast, was among them. The housing estate was a community very much in crisis, with little hope on the horizon.
We were all poor people. We never seen ourselves as poor, but we were poor people.
Finding your money for food, finding your money to buy clothes would have been difficult.
You know, the people went through a terrible period in that time. And they needed somebody to tell them they were good and they were alive and they were hopeful.
Hope was to come from a most surprising and inspirational source. The iconic figure of Mother Teresa, renowned throughout the world for her humanitarian and peacekeeping work, was persuaded to come to Belfast. So in October 1971, Mother Teresa and four of her sisters of charity moved into a house in the troubled area of Ballymurphy. 123 Springhill Avenue would be their home for the next 18 months.
She came and attended the Mass on the Sunday. They knew who she was, and they gave her a round of applause, which was very unusual. Churches were very sedate places in those days.
Everybody was all excited. The chapel was overcrowded. We welcomed them in and we chat with them, and at first it was embarrassing because I couldn't understand some of the things they were saying, talking that quick.
We seen these nuns with the blue and white, very, very striking robes. And who are they? You know? And remember, we were 16 years of age, 15, 16 years of age, and The first thing that we said, not bottle it.
They just melted into the parish, and the people just flocked around them.
Mother Teresa and her sisters were welcomed by a community in despair, a community desperate for help. But what she would soon realize was that the hospitality and generosity of spirit received from the people would not be forthcoming from certain sections within the Catholic Church, who, according to rumor, would ultimately order Mother Teresa and her four sisters out of Ballymurphy.
I believe that Mother Teresa was asked to leave Belfast, and given 24 hours to get out, there has to be something very sinister behind that.
We ask you, Lord, to bless them with us and to help us to live together in peace.
Some of the rumours were probably quite correct, that there were senior clergy who did not want them there. They made a number of arguments, and one was that, first of all, we didn't need missionary sisters. Secondly, that they would have nothing special to offer that Irish religious wouldn't be able to offer. And thirdly, although this was said beneath the voice, like it was sotto voce, this, that money would be better coming to the normal places that it went to in the church.
Now, for the first time, using the testimonies of the people who worked and lived alongside Mother Teresa and her sisters, the mystery of why they left Northern Ireland so abruptly can be examined.
What I liked about Mother Teresa and our nuns was that they lived with us. They came in to live with us. I was in their house, I think it was at 123 Spring Hill Avenue, and we were in there and they had nothing.
I never saw poverty, even in Ballymurphy, till I saw them nuns. Sad.
When the nuns came and they started to show us love, and just by practice, by actually listening to you and talking to you, we responded. And just like every other kids at that particular time, we just needed somebody to come and say, look, everything's all right.
I do remember going in and out of the house and feeling very happy and excited. My mum says to me that I actually ran up to her and said to her, Mummy, I think that that's God's mummy. I think that's Our Lady in that wee house.
One of the nuns was digging in the garden. I mean, the gardens in Spring Hill were just like rock. Hard clay that's been laying there for years, hard rock. And the four of us dug the garden for the nuns. And they gave us lemonade. Now, we never ever got that. It was too expensive for us to buy. And that's what they gave us. And they gave us two glasses of three-tap diluted juice for digging the garden. And we were quite happy to do it.
She wouldn't have been one for small talk. She would ask you how you were and what are we going to talk about. But I also would have understood that if somebody said to Mother Teresa that they would tell them how she would do her work in the area, she would just say no.
There came a time when Corpus Christi Church no longer had a sacristan, and Mother Teresa's nuns were asked to take on the care of the altar and the church, etc. Now, without thinking it through, you would imagine they would jump at that. But they didn't. They said, no, that is not our work. And they were quite adamant about it. They were not going to take on something which was not in the spirit of their service of people.
She was, in ways, would have been an awkward person for bureaucracy or any establishment to deal with, because she had a very fixed focus.
Father Wilson decided that he would have a little party in the National Hotel. It was just going to be a little buns and sandwiches. So Sister Genevieve couldn't contain herself. She couldn't wait. And then, just as the bus arrived into Spring Hill Avenue, the Sister Georgina came out, and she said that they weren't able to come. They weren't allowed to come. And of course, Father looked, you know, he says, "What do you mean, Sister, you're not allowed?" And Sister Genevieve said, "Well, Mother Teresa said it would not be right for us to be seen going into a hotel." And Sister Genevieve was in tears. She really was. And they all waved us off where we went. But when Mother spoke, "I'm afraid, Mother," had the final word.
While Mother Teresa's no-nonsense and forthright character was popular with the people she served, she found that this approach would put strains on her relationship with local canon Padraic Murphy, who did not appear to appreciate her candour.
Canon Murphy, who was the parish priest at that time, had a very distant relationship with the sisters, never quite approved of them. These were called missionary sisters, and quite definitely there were people who thought, "We send missionaries abroad. They don't send missionaries to us." And I regret to say that it would have been among some of the senior clerical people in this town.
A close colleague of Canon Murphy, Father Sean McCartney, attempts to shed some light on why Mother Teresa and the canon did not see eye to eye.
At the beginning, I think, you know, Ricky was a bit offended, by, especially by Desi Wilson. I mean, that Desi had invited them in, you know, Father Wilson, you know, rather than go through him. I mean, he told me how Bishop Philbin had asked him not to cause any problems with Mother Teresa, in spite of the fact she had come in without any permission from the bishop or from the parish priest. They came uninvited. But Bishop Philbin said, in view of the high profile of Mother Teresa, he didn't want any bad publicity. And I believe that Padraic sort of accepted that. He was a person who would always speak his mind. And he did tell her, "You know, Mother Teresa, your sisters need to adapt to the different culture, the different situation in Ballymurphy." He had a saying, you know, "Ballymurphy is very different from Bangladesh. There's poverty in both places, but they are different types of poverty." Canon Murphy put that across to Mother Teresa. She didn't particularly accept that. So I think, you know, I could understand the tension between the two of them.
I noticed the canon several times when I was there. In my presence, he was very rude. Very rude. Very, very rude.
He walked over people. He literally walked over people's heads. He didn't care about their feelings. He didn't care about them.
I think he would have saw her as being a wee foreigner coming in here, trying to tell him what to do.
He felt he knew what was best for the people. And undoubtedly, he would find it strange that missionaries were coming here rather than missionaries from here going to other parts. But I don't think that was the problem.
He was a man who liked to control things. And he believed he always did the will of God.
Sister Genevieve came up to my house. And she was in an awful state. And I says, "What's the matter? Come in, come on in." And she says, "The canon sent this letter up this morning." And I says, "What is it?" And she says, "It's an electric bill." And I says, "Why did he send it up to you?" And she says, "I don't know, but we have no money." And he put her through that agony that wee nun didn't know where to turn.
Despite this clash of personality with Canon Murphy, Mother Teresa and her sisters continued to deliver charity to those in most need.
They looked after the people, and maybe sometimes they'd have brought food. If there wasn't enough food in the house, they might have brought food very quietly, very nicely. It was done, and nobody would have known, only the family they were going to.
They were doing classes. One of the classes was taping. But to be honest, I have to be truthful, I wasn't really interested in taping, because one of them was very, very beautiful, and not to say anything about the women of Spring Hill, but there wasn't too many beautiful women about, you know. So Mother Teresa came in, and she put her hand on my shoulder and says, "Welcome." And I said, "Thank you, sister." She says, "Are you here to learn?" I says, "I hope so." And she says, "Mona, I'll show you what you have to do." So she showed me how to tape.
Well, the sisters have got children whom they are teaching, and they have a commercial class and a sewing class, and they visit the families, and they're doing quite a lot in the families. But I think that their very presence, the witnessing Christ's love, Christ's compassion, has been a peaceful or a soothing effect on the people.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, brother, there's far too many of you dying.
Mother Teresa and her sisters had a policy of not getting involved in local politics.
Many a time we crossed the Shankill Road in a car and had reasons to be stopped by the soldiers, and they would have pulled us out, and she put her hand out and she touched his gloves. He said, "Mother Teresa," and she put her hand on him and she says, "You'll be all right, son."
They went out of the bombs and the shooting, they went on about their business. We were frightened to death.
However, living in Belfast would expose them to some of the most shocking scenes of the Troubles.
It was the 4th of November, 1971. The paratroopers came in. Every single person was took off the street and put under house arrest. And Mummy got upset because there was a man across from us and she could see him being put into a Saracen for no apparent reason. And she just said, "Right, that's it now. We're not getting down, and just put on a red card and we'll lift our spirits and everything will be fine." So we put on Eamon Larkey and Kathleen singing Four Green Fields. This soldier came from behind a Saracen and shot her. When she turned round, Edna was at one side of her, I was at the other side, and Mummy had no face.
Mummy shot her!
And I just wanted to die. When you're the mother of 11 children and you've led a very active life, to be told you'll never see your children again, I just couldn't accept it.
She underwent surgery for about 9 hours, and that evening, they came and told us that Mummy had no eyes and that she would have to be told. And we just couldn't do it. So he said that Mother Teresa was actually in the building. He said he would speak to her and ask if she would speak to Mummy. So we said yes, because I'm the second oldest and the rest were all younger than me. I mean, how do you go in and tell your Mummy? But I do think Mother Teresa had an input and Mommy eventually accepting being blind. And she did accept it.
It would not be the troubles that would be Mother Teresa and her sister's hardest challenge. An even greater test lay ahead, as, according to rumour, they would be forced to leave Belfast. The shadow surrounding their untimely departure has haunted locals ever since.
They were gone without much ceremony. In fact, I think without any ceremony at all.
About 6 o'clock, somebody came and knocked the door and they said, Mrs. Polly, do you know the nuns are leaving? And I says, what? So I says, no, they're not. She says, they are. So we both went down and the place was crowded, crowded with people.
Mother Teresa and her sisters were not the only nuns asked to leave that day. Sister Eileen Sweeney from the Order of the Holy Child was also given her marching orders from Canon Murphy.
Sister Eileen, she had heard about the nuns moving out, so she went to the canon. She went down to Canon Murphy and she wanted to know why. Why they were gone so suddenly, what had happened. And he said, oh, we have our own sisters here, he says, and if you don't agree, you can go too.
And I asked him for a reason why he asked us to do something like that all of a sudden. And he said, I don't have to give you any reasons. And I remember telling him that I have just recently signed a contract with the school, and you can't just sign a contract and then 3 days later just break it for no good reason. And he says, I will see that that contract is invalidated. And he did, and I think he may well have done it more or less on the spot, because I heard very shortly afterwards that I no longer had a contract with that school, and it had been Canon Murphy who had stopped the contract.
Father Murphy came in and he looked at all of us, and of course the people were ready. Oh, they were in a terrible state, and they said, why was the nuns, why are they gone? And he says, oh, we have some of our own nuns coming, it'll be all right, we have some of our own gone. And said to him, well, some of our own nuns, well, they're long about coming. The people here were in distress. Nobody came. Oh, he said, you're a group of malcontents. That's what he called us, a group of malcontents.
There was going to be certainly a march on the canon's house. And it was only the cool heads of some of the community leaders at the time who stopped the windows being smashed, for instance.
People were crying and people were so distressed. They didn't know what happened. They didn't know why. Nobody knew.
To add to the confusion, there were other rumours suggesting the IRA were using the situation for their own gain.
I met a British soldier, really was an ex-British soldier, I should say. And he shared something with me which I didn't know. He said the night Mother Teresa was being put out, they received a call to the Army headquarters that the IRA were using Mother Teresa to start a riot in the area. And he said when he arrived up, he said that the women and children, everybody was out in the street, and they were prepared for a battle or draft because they were told there were hidden gunmen among the people. And he said, but all of a sudden, this little, small, frail little nun came out and she waved her hands. And he realized then what was Mother Teresa, and the troop, the British Army, withdrew from the area. But he said if she hadn't come out, he reckoned could have run bloodbath that night.
Local people immediately put pressure on the church to clarify the situation.
I rang the bishop's house and I upped the ante a bit by saying that they're being put out. I said, these nuns deserve to be thanked for all the work they've done in this area before they're put out. And I used that phrase on purpose just to see what response I would get. And I was told, oh, they're not being put out.
Bridget, wee Bridget, she knows the full ins and outs, if you can get her to talk about it.
Bridget McKeown had a very close relationship with Mother Teresa.
And I just couldn't believe it. Mother says, sit down, Bridget, and she told me quite a lot. And I just says, Nurse, she says, I put it on you, you will not talk about it. I'm crying at her wishes. I never will want to say what happened. Never. I would cry. No way. I says I will carry it to my grave. But she did suffer. I was present when he was very, very rude to the superior. Very, very rude.
Canon Murphy died in 1988. Without ever speaking openly about what happened that day. Father Sean McCartney tells the canon's version of offence for the first time.
He said Mother Teresa came down. She said, I'm going to withdraw my nuns. Canon Murphy said, when? And she says, they will be on the 7 o'clock boat tomorrow morning. And he said, you can't do that. If you go as suddenly as that, they will blame Canon Murphy for pushing you out. And he said, no, they wouldn't. And he said, I know better, the people better here than you do. They'll definitely blame me. And then she said, I will give you a letter saying that I go of my own accord with no pressure from you. And he said, then they'll blame the bishop. I give you a letter for him. And then Canon Murphy said, if you leave there tomorrow morning at 6:30, there'll be a family come in and squat in that house before lunchtime. I need you, I appeal to you sort of to give me some time. And I remember him, Mother Teresa pointed the finger at him and said, for you, I will make an exception. I will make an exception to my usual practice. The nuns will not go tomorrow morning, the morning afterwards. And I said to Canon Murphy, why don't you sort of tell that story? There's a very different impression out there. And he said he felt he never got a fair hearing where the media was concerned. He felt he was like getting into a boxing ring with his right arm tied behind his back.
The Catholic Church, as Father Edward McGee explains, have found letters in the archives written by Mother Teresa that they believe proves she left Ballymurphy of her own free will.
In the church announcements, we see the letter that was delivered by Mother Teresa to the people of Corpus Christi. I'm taking the sisters from here. No one has forced me. We have nothing to do with the rumours saying that we have been forced to go. God love each one in and round Belfast who have given us so much love and trust. Pray for us that we may do God's work with great love. God bless you, Mother Teresa. Maybe that's why Mother Teresa in her letter specifically mentioned the rumours, you know, that she addressed that issue specifically within her letter. I think also she would be someone who would have remained true to her conscience, and she would have said that the sisters left without compulsion because she believed that to be true as well.
That was true. It was absolutely true. She didn't tell a lie about it. It was their own decision. But it was a decision which had come about because she had no alternative. I think it was rather like what you get in industrial relations, you know, when people talk about constructive dismissal. It was creating a situation in which it was not possible to remain.
Well, 20 years after the sisters left Belfast,
I had the great privilege of driving Mother Teresa for a day on what turned out to be her last visit to Ireland. When she asked me where I was from, I said I was from Belfast. And again, she just lit up and she says, "Ah, Belfast. The people there are so loving and so warm. They're wonderful. And I would love, when we can, to send sisters back to Belfast." And I, in the back of my mind, was aware of some of the uncertainty, the controversy around the circumstances of the sisters leaving Belfast. I didn't want to ask her about it, but certainly I was left with no sense of rancor or concern or hesitation that if she decided that the sisters would go back to Belfast, that, you know, there was no sense that there would be any problem.
We can't detach the story of the sisters in Ballymurphy from the wider political situation that was there in Belfast at that time as well. This was a time of tremendous upheaval for the people where they were living. There were attacks on all sorts of individuals. And so there were probably real concerns for the lives of the sisters.
No, I don't believe there was the slightest connection with their safety. I mean, in a sense, the ordinary parishioners were more vulnerable. The ordinary clergy, from what happened, were more vulnerable.
Speaking in Ballymurphy at the time, Mother Teresa makes it very clear of her sister's intention to stay and continue to deliver their good work to the people.
When I heard about the trouble that was going on so very much, I sent word to them through the UK High Commissioner to tell them either to go to Dublin or to go to England, where we have a house of ours. And the sister sent me word back to say, "This is the time that our people need us most. We will stay with them." And so they have been very brave and they have stayed on. This thing has not upset them.
Despite this interview by Mother Teresa, the church still maintained that she decided to leave and withdraw her sisters voluntarily.
I draw your attention to a book that was written by a lady called Eileen Egan. Eileen was writing a biography of Mother Teresa. And in that book, she did recall the sisters living in Belfast. Now, in the first edition of this book, Eileen Egan made reference to the sisters having been asked to leave Belfast. But what was interesting, I was able to locate in the archives a letter from Eileen Egan to Bishop William Philbin. And in this letter, dated the June the 17th, 1986, it says, "It is clear to me that an error was made in describing how the sisters left Ballymurphy. Mother Teresa has stated that it was her decision to move the sisters to place them elsewhere. I take full responsibility for the error on pages 362, 375 of such a vision of the street, in which the decision to move the sisters was attributed to an unnamed church official."
According to those closest to Mother Teresa, another letter exists which could put an end to the rumours and speculation once and for all.
When the sisters had to leave, a lot of the people were tidying up and clearing up whatever was left.
And it was noticed there was this letter in the waste basket. So somebody thought it would be a marvellous memory of Mother Teresa to have a letter, to have her writing, her actual handwriting. And they took the letter and it was put together then and was realised that this was the original, her original emotions and feelings that she intended expressing to the bishop. That letter still exists, but I don't think anybody has seen it except the sister who took it from that room and looked on it as a most dear souvenir of Mother Teresa.
That nun was Sister Eileen Sweeney.
I just remember the house and the table and the torn up pile of paper lying on the table. And I said, "Now here is something written by Mother Teresa. And even though it's all torn up, it is something." And so we could have her, a piece of her actual writing. Then, whether that same day or soon after, tried to put these pieces together. But in the letter, she certainly started off
by saying that she felt very sorry for you. She said, Bishop, I feel sorry for you. What you said was most unkind. And then towards the end, she wanted to make sure that there wasn't a lot of bad feeling left in the community because of the new nuns coming in and two orders having been told to get out. And so she thought it was better that they agreed in advance that what they were saying to the people was the same in each case. Where it is now, God only knows where that letter is now.
Here you had this woman who was all for truth and integrity and service, tearing up a letter and disposing of it in the waste bin. You see, that was this sort of, I suppose, to an extent, blind obedience.
And the sanction of the people. That was not the sister's fault, but that's still there.
It's sad that in a Christian world, in a Christian part of the world, in the Catholic Falls Road, that one of the saints of our church now was asked to leave.
And I never got saying goodbye to the nuns. They were taken out, and none of us knew.
Should there be an apology for Mother Teresa? Yes, there should be. There should be an apology to the people of Spring Hill and Ballymurphy and the people of the Falls Road, the people who met Mother Teresa and who she came to help and protect. And it should come from the Pope and just straight down into the diocese of Denham. Thank you.